that I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I'll make faithfulness known to all generations. My prayer is that today in worship we will be able to sing, to make his faithfulness known. Prepare your hearts through this time with the prelude. Would you join with me in the opening prayer as it is found printed in our bulletins? Together we pray. Lord Jesus, in your faithfulness to us, you shower us with grace, mercy, love, and all we need. We pray that you would shape our hearts, that they would be filled with gratitude, that we might always return to you and give you thanks. Amen. Please remember the friendship pads are located in each pew. Thank you for signing, and if you're our guest today, thank you for signing and giving us a way to contact you. We want to give you a warm word of individual welcome. Please note that next week during the Sunday school hour at 10 o'clock in Ward Hall, there'll be an update from the missionaries from St. John's who went to Thailand. If you're interested in hearing on the work in Thailand, that's next Sunday, 10 o'clock in Ward Hall. Call your attention to the fact that the first Sunday in September will be a healing service also at 10 o'clock in the chapel. If you desire a healing for you or someone you know, love, physically, mentally, spiritually, please, the first Sunday in September, 10 o'clock in chapel, communion will be celebrated. Lastly, I want to share with you and to add that we have new members being received today, and if you'd like to be part of that group, you haven't made previous contact, just plan to come forward. We'd be delighted to receive you into membership.
Mark and Valerie Lockridge to come forward along with Henry Lockridge, who is 2, and Oliver, who is almost or just barely 2 months old. Mark was actually confirmed at St. John's in 1992, and his parents are still members here. He's the clubhouse manager at Augusta National. His wife, Valerie, stays at home with their 2 children, Henry and Oliver. Valerie is joining by profession of faith and will be baptized this morning, and Mark's membership will be restored. Come on.
If you would turn to page 33 in your hymnal. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated in God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without Christ. Valerie, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races?
I do.
And now, if you'll turn with me, page 36, number 10. The Lord be with you.
And also
with you.
Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water, and after the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow, and when you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord all the earth.
Tell us God's mercy each day.
In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection, and to make disciples of all nations, declare his word to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water, and she who will receive it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise
to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives, reigns forever. Amen.
Valerie Farrell Lockridge, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit work within you that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And now, let me ask Mark. When someone is reaffirming their faith, it's simply a question of asking them, do you remember your baptism and are you thankful?
I do and I am.
And now, brothers and sisters, it is our joy to welcome our new sister and brother in Christ. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation
and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood.
We are one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as members of Christ. For membership, I invite Linda Pixley to come forward. Linda is transferring her membership from Belgrove Baptist Church. Linda enjoys singing and hopes to look into singing in the choir. I present Linda Pixley, who comes to this congregation from a sister church this morning. Also, Anthony Council. Anthony is joining by profession of faith. Anthony says he is a jack of all trades, but mostly he says he is working for God. And we present Anthony, who is reaffirming his faith this morning. Also invite Elizabeth Green Cahill, who is already part of our chancel choir. We welcome her from Front Street United Methodist Church in North Carolina. She is a computer programmer and is looking for a Sunday school class and looking for other ways to become involved here at St. John's. I present Elizabeth Cahill, who comes from a sister church, Methodist Church in North Carolina. Also, Dave and Peggy Patrick are coming. They recently moved here from Maryland, and we welcome you to Aiken. They're transferring their membership from Bel Air United Methodist Church in Maryland. Dale is an optometrist, and Peggy is at home. And we welcome you. They attend both this service and 902 at times. So I present Dale and Peggy Patrick, who come from a sister Methodist church for membership. And also Bill recently started attending St. John's. He is joining by affirmation of faith. Bill is a retired chemist and worked for DuPont and enjoys golfing. I present Bill, who is reaffirming his faith this morning. And we also have the Bentley family, Jeffrey and Kimberly Bentley, and their daughter Ellie, who is 4, and Evan, who is 2. And I believe Evan is in the nursery at this time. Ellie and Evan were baptized in 2012 here at St. John's and are in our preschool program. And Jeffrey is joining by profession of faith. He's a chemical engineer with the Department of Energy at SRS. And Kimberly is transferring from a Lutheran church in Florida. She's originally from Chicago, and she's a stay-at-home mom now, but in her previous life, she was an English teacher. I present Kimberly, who is coming from a sister congregation in Florida, and Jeffrey, who is reaffirming his faith this morning.
Are there any others who wish to join these who are coming to profess their faith and become members of St. John's United Methodist Church? Then I would like to invite you to turn to page 38 in your hymnal, number 14. bags of information to welcome you to our congregation. And we're hoping that we will, every month,
Wesleyn Sage Bernard. Hannah Catherine Bage. Amelia Dean Harper. Chase Rowe Ingram. Luke Collins Jones. Ann Fenton Massey. Elena Murphy Parrott. Leighton Eric Proctor. Maya Ann Stephanakis. Alexandria Lee Vernon. Ashley Caroline Young.
And in worship, we will learn to gather and grow in our love of God's Word. Feet and a light to our path.
Let us stand as we affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Be seated. The pulpit mic is on, but not this one. Let us pray. Gracious God, there are so many things that are just minor, whether it be a sound system or saying a perfect word out of an order of worship. But in the whole scheme of things, there are so many things that are truly important. Family and friends, even our enemies that are suffering. People who are going through treatments for cancer. Those who are recovering from surgery. Those who are anticipating procedures in the future. Lord, homes where there is stress and strain, financial, emotional, and otherwise. Oh, Lord, help us to know on this, your day, the Lord's day, that you want us to keep the main thing, the main thing. So help us, Lord, to pray for our children as they have been given these Bibles, that indeed those Bibles may be a lamp unto their feet. And may your word be a guide and lamp to all of us as we walk through life. Hear our prayers for these children and their families. Hear our prayers for the children around the world in war-torn areas. Please let there be peace. Please stop persecution of your children and followers. Please, O Lord, protect those who've been through earthquake and tumult. Lord, bless, we pray, this community of Aiken, that we might be shining witnesses of your grace and love. O Lord, hear our prayers for ourselves. But especially we pray, hear our prayers for others. For this is our prayer that we make in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who has taught his disciples and has taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And now let us continue to worship God by the giving and receiving of our tithes and offerings.
people, if you'd like to participate in children's church, please follow the crucifer out. Our hymn, Break Thou the Bread of Life. Be seated. I'm not sure what happened to Dr. Tim. I assume he's getting his mic checked, but I'll read the scripture and we'll take it from there. In 2 Timothy, the third chapter, reading from the start of the 14th verse, keep on being faithful to what you were taught and to what you believed. After all, you know who taught you these things. Since childhood, you have known the Holy Scriptures that are able to make you wise enough to have faith in Christ Jesus and be saved. Everything in the Scriptures is God's Word. All of it is useful for teaching and helping people and for correcting them and showing them how to live. The Scriptures train God's servants to do all kinds of good deeds. The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I hardly read the cookbook anymore. Sure, some people say that you should read the cookbook all the time. I mean, after all, the cookbook does tell us how to live. But I've about had it with cooking and even being around other chefs. That sort of thing just isn't for me anymore. When I first became a chef, of course I read the cookbook. I read it all the time. In fact, before I was a chef, it was the cookbook that showed me how to become a chef. I'd sit and read over it for hours upon hours without end, poring over all the recipes that I'd like to make, things like pies and bakery dishes, things like steaks and marinades and all sorts of things. I was wishing I could bake and fry and whip up all those delicious sounding dishes. And then I got to the part of the cookbook that gave the instructions about how to become a chef. It was probably the happiest day of my life when I followed those directions and I became a chef. During those first months, I almost always had the cookbook under my arm wherever I went, and people would ask me, "What is that book and what are you doing with it?" I'd practically glow as I told them how I'd just become a chef and that I felt so empowered by the great chef that I wanted everyone to become a chef. But after 2 or 3 years, though, my study of the cookbook began to fall off. After all, I figured I was getting pretty good at this chef business, after all. I'd made most everything from beef stroganoff to petit fours, and they hadn't turned out too badly. Once in a while, I'd accidentally skip an ingredient. I'd use my pastry whip incorrectly, and the dish would flop. But I was getting quite a reputation as a cook, and I decided I didn't need to read the cookbook as much. Already, I'd stopped carrying the unwieldy thing around with me. People were giving me funny looks, you see. And I stopped reading a portion of the general instructions every day, especially the first two-thirds of the cookbook. It was about cooking in the old days and how it was back in the past. And after all, I told myself, we are people with food processors and microwaves. We don't use brick ovens. Well, besides, I was just too busy. I was too busy to read the cookbook. You know, to be a good chef, surely it would be just enough to cook, after all. So I didn't have to read and reread the recipes in the cookbook. So next I started to cook without reading the recipes first. I'd already read most of the popular ones, like making pizza and scrambling eggs. I'd already done those at least once, so anyway, I'd end up whipping up a chocolate cake without peeking at the recipe. And to my surprise and my pleasure, the chocolate cake would turn out okay. I mean, it was at least edible. I might have forgotten to put in the baking powder. I might have added a little extra, well, maybe a cup or two extra of flour. But at least it was passable. Before long, I found myself making complicated recipes without the cookbook. Things like souffles and turkey tetrazzini. I figured I knew enough about cooking. In some cases, I didn't even read the recipes at all. But I'd heard a lecture on how to cook. Sometimes I hadn't even heard a lecture, but I figured I knew enough about cooking to at least wing it. I'd substitute ingredients and guess at baking temperatures. And sometimes the results weren't exactly what you would enter in the state fair. I remember one concoction of chocolate chip cookies that you could drink through a straw. They tasted okay, but the texture was just awful. Eventually, I couldn't remember many recipes, so I began to invent my own recipes. I thought they were pretty close to the originals, but I couldn't be sure because somewhere along the way, I had misplaced my cookbook. Some people didn't think much of the recipes I invented. For instance, licorice burritos. I mean, who doesn't like licorice? Who doesn't like burritos? I thought it would just make sense to put them together. But a lot of people didn't like them. What was I supposed to do? Memorize recipes? I mean, really? That's why we have cookbooks, if I knew where mine was. A few of my cooking friends began to criticize me, saying I ought to read the cookbook more. I tried to calm them down by buying a brand new copy with gold gilt edges all over it. I brought it with me to cooking society meetings, making sure everyone saw it. Of course, I didn't open it. I did read cooking-related books, which were quite interesting. They talked about things like diets and recipes, grocery shopping, that sort of thing. And they had pictures, which was something that the cookbook didn't have. Well, gradually, my friends pestered me so much about getting involved in reading the cookbook that I decided I didn't want to be around them. When a friend would suggest that I spend more time in the cookbook, I would tell them I was watching one of those television cooking shows regularly. And I was at first, but then I quit doing that. And my interest in cooking waned. Finally, I stopped hanging around the kitchen altogether. I did want to look the part, though. You know, appearances are something. These days, I don't do much cooking. If I get really hungry, I'll warm up a TV dinner. And if I'm caught in a real bind, I'll whip up a hamburger or something like that. But the old zeal of being a chef just isn't there anymore. My old cooking friends just shake their heads now as they see me walking down the street, and they look at each other as if to say, I bet he doesn't even remember how to boil water. Those know-it-alls, of course I remember how to boil water. I just can't remember why. Paul wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3. And Paul wrote him and said that the Scripture is God-breathed. It is useful for correction, reproof, encouragement. It's good for recipes for life, to equip the person of God for every good deed. The cookbook that we believe in is the Bible. The United Methodist Church says that the Scriptures contain all things necessary for our salvation. It is the inspired Word of God. And yet, we sometimes go through life as the chef I just portrayed, and we think that after we have come to know Christ, we become too busy to learn the recipes, and we lose our Bibles. You third graders, don't lose your Bibles. And some of you adults, I hope you find yours or go out and buy that. Well, don't buy the big gold gilt-edged one, but at least open it. Because the Scriptures provide us with everything we need for when we're going through tough times. And there are snippets of recipes or Scriptures that I remember and recall that are favorites. Now, I didn't learn them in seminary. You know, a lot of people assume that people go to seminary so they can learn the Scriptures. Well, for those of us who've been to seminary, we more often than not call it cemetery rather than seminary. If you don't have faith and knowledge of the Scriptures before you get there, you probably might not receive it once you do. So how do you look at the cookbook? How do you read the cookbook? Is it something in your daily practice to read the Scripture? Hopefully more than just reading the upper room, although that can be a helpful thing, especially if you read the chapter before and the chapter after and ask God while you're reading it, as you're praying, please, Lord, show me what this means for me today. Paul told Timothy, you know those from whom you learned the Scriptures. And we know in 2 Timothy chapter 1 that Timothy learned the Holy Scriptures from his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice, and how from infancy he had known these Scriptures that were able to give him life, to instruct him, to enable him to have a recipe for a happy life. Now, I don't know anyone in this sanctuary this morning that doesn't want a happy life. We all want a happy life. We all want to fulfill what God has in store for us. And let me share with you, just briefly, some of the Scriptures that come to my mind when I'm having a tough time. And I want you to think about that this week. What are the Scriptures that come to your mind? Because this is God's Word. This is the cookbook for life, something for which you cannot substitute. It is God-breathed. It is that important. For instance, I think about when I feel a little bit poorly about myself, or I listen to others, or as I think about these children, all of the children who end up being bullied or called names because they might be different in some way or fashion or another. I'm reminded of Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, that says that I and all of the rest of us are made in the image of God. So when I feel bullied or put down or different from other people, would it not be good for us to remember that no matter what, everyone is made in the image of God? Don't ever feel bad about yourself. I also remember from the words of the Old Testament, different scriptures like Joseph being sent by his brother, sold into slavery, being sent to Egypt, and there he got into more trouble. But then, even as he was in prison, God gave him a vision about how the people of Israel, even though they went through a famine, they could be fed. And then the famine arrived. Joseph in Egypt, they were prepared. But then Joseph's brothers from Palestine came to Egypt looking for food to buy, and Joseph forgave them and said to them, "What you meant for evil, God turned to good." And then later, when another Pharaoh came on board and treated the people of God poorly, and they were enslaved, God sent Moses and Aaron and Joshua to set the people free and lead them through the wilderness into the promised land. Doesn't that give you comfort to know that we can forgive others? That what has been bad can be turned into something good? That even though we've been enslaved by temptation or whatever the case may be, God can set us free. We do not have to remain in bondage. I remember a little boy whose name was David, who was the smallest and youngest of all of Jesse's sons. You know the story, at least some of you who know the cookbook as well as I, or even perhaps I pray better than I do. But little David, he was selected to go out and fight this 9-foot-tall giant named Goliath. And they tried to put Saul's armor on him, Saul, the king of Israel. But his armor was too big and clanky, and so he took it off and just dressed in his shepherd outfit, he went out and faced this 9-foot-tall giant, and he picked up a few stones, and he used his slingshot that he had used against wild animals attacking his sheep, and he took Goliath out. And let me tell you, when I feel surrounded by the giants of life, maybe when you feel surrounded by the giants of life, doesn't it do us good to know that God can use even little old us? Seems like Jesus says something in the New Testament about children coming into Him because He said, "Of such is the kingdom of God." Sometimes when we're weak, we're strongest. I'm reminded of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, where Paul said he had a thorn in the flesh. But he would boast all the more gladly about his weaknesses because God said to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." God uses our weaknesses to make great things. Or we could talk about Daniel in the lion's den and how God saved him. Or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when they were in the fiery furnace and King Nebuchadnezzar looked inside and he saw 4 people, not just 3. Because Jesus was with them even then. So when we're going through tough times, God's with us. And who doesn't recall the 23rd Psalm? That prayer, that psalm that is said in every foxhole perhaps and beside every deathbed. We could probably say it together if we tried, and why don't we? "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The Lord provides for us. And one of the greatest gifts of all, of course, we read about in John's Gospel, in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world, so loved you, and so loved me, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The scriptures also tell us that the wages of sin is death. And because Jesus never sinned, death could not keep its grip on him. And so Jesus was resurrected and rose from the dead and broke free from the bonds of death, giving us hope that as we have faith in Christ, we too shall overcome death. I remember the words of Romans chapter 8 that says to us all when we're going through difficult times, much like Joseph in the Old Testament, that all things work together for good to those that love God, who are called according to His purpose, that neither death nor life nor angels nor demons nor anything present nor anything in the future, nothing in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. Through Christ, we are more than conquerors. How much hope that gives me, and I hope it gives you. Well, there are scriptures abounding that are part of the recipe for my life. What are the recipes for your life? I remember the one finally from John 14, where Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. In my Father's house are many restaurants." No, it doesn't say that. "Are many mansions." Surely they had dining rooms, though. "And the great chef ministered to them. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so," Jesus said, "I would have told you. But I go there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, you may be also." And Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" But Jesus replied, saying, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And later in that same passage of John, he says, "Because I live, you shall live also. And greater things than these you shall do." So God is with us, and God has given us a cookbook. Well, not this one so much as this one. I pray that as you read it this week, it will strengthen you. It will lead you and guide you. For it is God's inspired word. It is a recipe for happiness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you both now and forevermore. Cook something up for Jesus. Amen.